Let's go to the positive aspect of it. Number one, there is no such thing as a neutral worldview. Number two, a good worldview should have a high degree of coherence or internal consistency. The law of non-contradiction works. Those of you remember me illustrating it to you yesterday, how powerfully it can be illustrated. You cannot challenge the law of non-contradiction. A logically contradictory statement cannot be true. Remember that. A logically contradictory statement cannot be true. Number three, a good worldview will have a strong foundation in fact. It's called correspondence. Four, a good worldview has explanatory power. Five, a good worldview will avoid both extremes of what they call Occam's razor and reductionism. You know, Occam said this, don't multiply entities without necessity. That means he said, don't make your philosophy too complicated. He said, if you do, my razor will hack it off. It's called Occam's razor in philosophy. When you say, somebody says, what's the Occam's razor test? If a theory gets too complicated, the razor chops it off. But the opposite of that is reductionism. Let me say, for example, something like this. If I say man is a brute, that's a reductionistic statement. If you say, what is an apple? And I say, it's a fruit, it's red. You've got some idea. But suppose you say, what is an apple? And I say, it's a thing. You say, is that all you got to say? That's a kind of a reductionistic argument of an apple. But then I can also write 20 pages on an apple. If I write 20 pages, Occam's razor will cut it off. If I just say it's a thing, reductionism cuts it off. A good worldview must maintain a balance between these two extremes. It mustn't be so complicated that you can't understand it. I have always maintained that to be a good Buddhist, you need a graduate degree in philosophy. You cannot understand Buddhism otherwise. Five, a good worldview will avoid the two extremes, as I said. Number six, a good worldview is established not by one line of evidence or one knockout argument, but by cumulative evidence. It's like this. A good worldview is like a stage manager who's going on to turn on the lights that crisscross across the stage. When all of the lights are on, the purpose of those lights is so that center stage would be clearly visible. When you have made a good argument for Christ, at the end of your argument, it is Christ that needs to be plainly visible. People often ask me, what is the task of an apologist? I put it this way, to clear the bushes so that they can get an unobstructed view of Christ. Apologia, an answer back, to clear the bushes so they can get an unobstructed view of Christ. That's what it takes.